morning, everybody. Let's try that one more time. Good morning. Thank you. Thank you so much. If you're watching online, welcome. If you're here, welcome too. And I see people outside. Come on in. Let's stand and worship God, please.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending, descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord. Show us, yes, show us your glory, show us your power, show us. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Yeah. Open up the heavens. We want to see. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Can we give a hand clap for God, please? Amen, amen, amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Amen. King.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. you've done for me.
Amen.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace.
Yes.
This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Y'all give Jesus a hand clap of praise. Thank you. I'm so thankful to be here today. My name's Ross. I am the new pastor here. I'm so thankful to be here. So glad to be worshiping with you today. If you want to give, we give right here in these baskets in the back towards the door. If you are new here or we don't have your email, we want you to get the Connect card. And I want you to know a little bit about our November calendar, okay? So here we go, November. We're going to have November 21st, this really special event at the church. Does anybody know what that is?
Workday.
Workday, what's up? Okay, so we're going to have a workday. And you've already signed up. If you haven't signed up, then talk to Bogan, and you can add your name to the list, and we would love to get you out here. There's a question about whether there's going to be childcare. I don't know yet, okay? We're working on childcare. We're going to put the bouncy house out there, and we're planning this right here, right now in front of everybody. This is awesome. So we're so glad you're here. Yeah, so November 21st, come here, come ready to work. The vision we want here, guys, is this first impressions opportunity where people come in here and they just get excited before they've even entered the sanctuary because of the discipline and the beauty of the play. So that's one of the visions we have right now for November 21st. Then the next week, plus 29th. I'm pretty sure November 29th is that Sunday. That Sunday, is it 28th? Oh. 29th, yeah. November 29th, we're going to do a baby dedication. So if you got a little baby and you want your baby to get dedicated, Angelica, get Christian up in here, what you're going to do is you're going to tell the church that I'm raising my kid in the Lord, and the church is going to tell you we're here for you, we're here with you, we're here in that same mission with you. So if you have little ones that need to be dedicated, that will be on the 29th when we start our Christmas season. So excited, guys. Let me pray us back into worship, and we'll keep going with this, and we'll keep being filled with the Spirit. Holy Spirit, we just thank you. God the Father, we thank you. Jesus the Son, we thank you. And we invite Father, Son, and Holy Spirit right now. Because we don't do anything without Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that's of any good in this world. Jesus says, if you're not connected to the vine, you can forget about it. You're not going to do any good. But if we're connected to Jesus and the works that we do are the things that God wants us to do, those things flourish and grow. So, Father, we come to connect today to the vine, to be in you and to worship you, Father. We want to be grounded in Christ. We want to be filled with the Spirit as we sing in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Lord Jesus, come visit us now. Holy Spirit, come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that there are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
There's nothing.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better. To show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain, he is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find us again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Glory, yes, you're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways, you're the only. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out. It's working all things out. Yes. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Your name. Fail me now. He won't fail me now. Yes, in the waiting. The same God that's never late. He's working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Can't stand again.
Sing us out.
Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, we will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my days. Oh, yes, reckless love of God. Oh. leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away, and all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so good to me. When I felt no worth, yes, you paid it all for me. And you have been so kind to me.
Let's thank you.
Still you give yourself away, and all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, yeah. God, we thank you. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, you're coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Yeah, there's no shadow you won't light up, a mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Don't deserve it, still you give yourself away, and all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God,
Thank you, Lord. You said that we were like a lost coin or a lost sheep, and you left the 99 and you came after us. That's reckless. Some people don't like that song, Lord, but I don't know what else to call it. Leaving 99, going after one, Lord, but that's what you do and that's what you did for me. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you that you have just visited us this morning. And that somebody in here today is accepting the love of God. That somebody in here today is seeing that God has been after them. and that God is touching their life and that God wants them for his own. Somebody in here today knows they have been chosen. Thank you, God. Continue to come after and pursue us. In your name and your glory we pray. Amen. You guys can greet your neighbor or also be up in a minute. All right, everybody, let's find our seats as we continue in worship, praising God, thanking him. Thank you so much, worship team, for bringing us into the presence of God. I'm excited about the love of God. I don't know if anybody else in here is excited about that. Well, all right, team, all right. I know you love each other. That's just peace. So glad to be here today. Last week we talked about fullness. We talked about how full God wants this church to be. We talked about full of diversity, full of people from the edges, and full of the Holy Spirit. So we're going to zero in on full of the Holy Spirit today and talk about how a church can be full of the Holy Spirit. And we talked about singing songs and like just like we did, you're full through singing. Some people don't like singing, but that's because they don't like being filled. You know, they don't like being filled with the Holy Spirit, you know. So that's kind of who they are. But they're going to loosen up a little bit. You know, I loosened up a little bit when I was young and I decided, you know what, I'm just going to go ahead and sing. It ain't girly to sing. I'm going to sing so I can be filled because I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Word of God says, sing and make melody in your hearts to the Lord. And be filled. So we're talking about the church that's full and talk about a church that's full of the Holy Spirit. And one of the things that makes you full in the New Testament is devotion. Devotion makes you full. And if you look at what you're devoted to, that's what you're full of. If you look at what you're devoted to, that's what you're full of. You may be full of some stuff you don't want to be full of, but we know that you're full. Well, you know what you're full of based upon what you're devoted to. What are you devoted to? If you're just kind of like everybody else in our society, you're really full of Netflix. You're really full of that. You're devoted. Just admit it. You're devoted. You're committed every night. You got a standard daily bread. It's Netflix, and you just devoted. I ain't dissing Netflix. I'm just saying that's what you're full of. You're full of some social media. You're just full of everybody's likes or dislikes of you. You're full of your next post idea. You're full of somebody's political thought that was random on Facebook. You're all day thinking about what you're going to respond to because you're full. You're full of that stuff. You're full of ESPN. Because you just love sports and you're committed to it and you're full. And you know, when somebody gets injured, it's like it's your own got injured and you're just sad. I can't believe that my guy broke his leg and he's going to be out for this season. You're full of some stuff, man. And I'm not sure if what you're full of is what you want to be full of. But in the New Testament, we talk about being full of the Holy Spirit. One of the words we got to talk about is what you're devoted to. So when Jesus left, he left some disciples, you know, in Jerusalem. And there was only 120 of them, 12 main ones, and then all their families. There was only 120 of them. He left them there and he said, you guys wait until you get filled. I want you to be full. So he left him there for like 3 weeks. And they were devoted. It says in Acts 1, verse 14, while they were waiting, they returned to Jerusalem Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, and a Sabbath day journey away. And all these with one accord. Well, I don't know what it says. Because they're, you know, that's missing a verse. I said, comma, verse 14. No, it's good. Now, if you do have your Bibles with you, I can just quote it by memory. It says in verse 14, it says that they were all together in prayer. That they were devoted to prayer. And so they were devoted to something which preceded the coming of the Holy Spirit. So if you remember in Acts 2, it was, I'm just going to tell you the story. The Holy Spirit comes, it's like a sound of a rushing wind, and it fills the place where these 120, about kind of like us, where these 120 were sitting, and that empowered them, that revitalized them, that caused them to be born. The church was born with the Holy Spirit. And guess what? The church does not get revitalized without the Holy Spirit. That's why we're talking about being filled. Because they get filled as they're devoted in Jerusalem for a matter of like 3 weeks, just praying and worshiping in Jerusalem, waiting on the next holiday and waiting on God to show up at Pentecost. So Jesus dies on Passover and they're waiting till Pentecost. That's a long time. And they're devoted. So what you're devoted to makes you who you are, tells us what you're full of. When you're devoted to like that, the Holy Spirit is just going to visit. The Holy Spirit's just going to come. He can't help it. Once you start praising God and worshiping God and thanking God and you just got gratitude all over you, you've got the love of God in your heart, man. The Holy Spirit's just all over you and you're full, man. Because you're devoted. You're giving your time to things that are godly. You're giving your time to things that are, and you're living a life full of gratitude. I want to be full. I want to be a part of a church that's full. I don't want to be full of it. I want to be full of Him. And to be full, we've got to be devoted. So what were they devoted to? What were they devoted to? Acts 2, 42 through 47. Do we have those verses up here? Acts 2, 42?
No.
No. did y'all notice I have my Bible up here? And I can actually utilize that. This is the reading for the day. Acts 2, 42. You can turn in your Bibles there now. And we're going to talk about what they were devoted to. Acts 2, 42. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. They were full and they were devoted. And the Holy Spirit visited, and their response was more devotion. And in their devotion, then awe came upon everybody. And there was presence. The presence of the Holy Spirit. And this is a church that's being formed, being established, and this is the church before it explodes on the world scene. Verse 46 says what they were devoted to. It says, day by day attending the temple and breaking bread in their homes. You see, they were devoted to two things. The temple and the table. They were devoted to two things. They were devoted to the big temple because when they were gathered together the first time, there was a sermon preached and everybody, like 3,000 people, got saved. So when the church was born, it was born as a big group of people. And this big group of people was meeting in the temple courts. So they were all together in the temple courts when they all got saved. And so they had a habit of day by day going back to the temple to be all together. So the church was this big extravaganza meeting of worship and preaching and celebration. And that's their big church experience. And then they didn't just have their big church experience. Like some people just have that big church experience. They don't have this other type of experience, which is called the house church experience, the table experience, the community experience. They were committed to the temple experience, and they were committed to the table experience, which was the community experiencing the love of God through community with each other. And so these two things, if we can just say what we're going to be devoted to as a church and where we're headed as a church, these two things, devotion to the temple and the table, devotion to big church and small church. Do you have the big church devotion? Do you have the small church devotion? The big church is the Sunday morning extravaganza. It's what we're doing now. It's the Sunday morning splash. And what it does when we all get together like this is it reminds us, okay, this is our body of people. It reminds us that we're unified. Then we take communion and we consolidate or we confirm that unity in taking communion. And we hear the word preach because you just kind of awkward to hear a sermon if there's only 12 people in the room. And so you gotta, if you're going to have preaching be a part of your community at all, then you're going to do it in a big temple type bigger setting. And so they were committed to this bigger experience because they wanted the bigness gives you energy. It's like when there's people in the room. I've noticed as a church planner when it's like 80 people, when there's like 80 people in a room, it's like whoa, things just kind of like flip, and there's just more energy. And when you talk about getting 3,000 in a room, I mean it's incredible. And so when you get these people together and you hear the word preached, and hearing the word preached is a different experience than hearing it just discussed. Because when you hear it preached, it's like really coming to you in a more forceful way, really. And so if we're going to have preaching and we're going to, you know, we were saved by preaching, hello. So to continue to grow in Christ, much of that is through preaching and being committed to the New Testament, the apostles' teaching, like we just read, but the big experience, they were committed to that. It was part of their devotion. So they were also committed to the local table, be around here, hold hands, pray. I remember being in Saluda, and we had like three people in our group that didn't have jobs. And this is my life group. And three of them didn't have jobs. And so every week we would pray for one of them to get a job. And like slowly, surely, week by week, in 3 weeks, all three of them got jobs. And that's something that's really cool that can happen in an exciting way when you're in the table context. Because you know enough about that person to know what they need. And you start to experience what love is, because love is a very personal kind of experience. And so they were committed to the big thing. Now, house church people, if you know people that kind of tout house church, they don't really like what I'm saying right now because they want to say that Christianity is all about the house church. But I'm telling you, it's about both. God's a big both and God. He's a big God. And so this Sunday morning extravaganza, what we're calling the Sunday morning splash, is going to be a part of our church culture, and we're going to do that well. People are like, Ross, what are you going to do? How's the church going to be revitalized? We're going to do Sunday morning well. And we're not going to build a school, and we're not going to build other programs, and we're not going to do a whole lot until we get first things first. Until we've got that figured out, we don't have layer one down of church revitalization. So church revitalization is just getting the temple experience down and being committed to that and getting that executed. And if you don't realize, it takes about 8 to 10 teams every Sunday to pull this off. You're like, whoa, I just came and showed up at like 10:05, and I didn't know that. There's people worshiping before you get here by serving. There's people worshiping before you get here because they have to make the coffee. And the coffee's just getting better and better because we're learning how to use that coffee machine. And the Waylands are just killing it, getting here an hour early so the coffee machine can work, praise God. So there's I'm going to just name some of the teams. So you know when we do Sunday morning, what we're really doing and why. When somebody pulls into that driveway right there, the first thing they experience is our grounds. And they're judging what the sermon's going to be like before they've even come in here. And you just be honest. When you saw those dead maple trees, you're like, mm-hmm, dead maple trees, that might mean a dead church. No, but they don't really care that much, but they care somewhat. Our ground's disciplined. So we've put haze over the grounds and over the facilities inside so that we can kind of tighten just the discipline of having a space that's beautiful and disciplined. And let me tell you something. In the book of Leviticus, if you ever read that, you probably were smoking something because it's really hard to read. But if you ever read that book, you notice one thing about the presence of God. The presence of God comes with discipline. The presence of God comes with discipline. You got to manage the altar. You got to like clean it. You got to like take care of it and make sure the water's there and make sure the firewood's there. And you got to make sure everything's clean and ready. And you got to be a place that can host the presence of God. And it takes discipline. And when people come here and they see that we're disciplined, that's one of the aspects of being full of the Holy Spirit. It's that devotion to just the simple things of excellence that makes you great. And so when they come here and they go in the facilities and they have that experience, they go to the cafe and the Waylands are over the cafe. Now, by the way, if you want to join any of these teams, is why the reason I'm calling out names. So if you want to join any of these teams, whether it be Hayes' team, he needs your help. If you're a fix-it guy, he needs you on his team. If you're a cafe person and you want to help us with the food element of what we're doing, then the Waylands are your people. Go talk to them and get involved. But you come here and we want to be a culture of hospitality. And so we were setting out food so that people will stay and talk and be a part of a community. So that's what we're doing. We want to have good food out there. And then when you pass cafe, you go to kids check-in. And the kids people are killing it. They are killing it. Yes. The kids people are killing it because, you know, you're checking in your kids and then they are thinking long term, years in advance, the style and the program that will get a kid to a certain place. And I would play a video right here, but I'm going to send you guys an email with a video connected to it about the program that we're using. But it's called the Gospel Project. And it teaches the Bible, and it talks about each story and how it relates to Jesus. And so it's, you know, when I learned the Bible, we just kind of learned the story. But when Jesus taught the disciples, he said, listen, it's all about me. And if you're not talking about Jesus in every single story, then you're not interpreting the Bible correctly. Because Jesus is the thread of the entire Bible. So we're going to get a program for our kids that makes them, by the time they get to high school, love some Jesus. And it won't be our fault. It won't be our fault if they don't love some Jesus. And so it's called the Gospel Project. And we're going to have videos connected to it. And we're going to have great teaching. And they're going to have worship. I'm telling you, those kids over there, in their worship, Jesus said, become like the little children. Become like the little children. The little children over there dancing, hopping around, having a good time. They're just going to have great worship. They're going to have a word for them. And I'm so thankful for that team. If you want to get involved, talk to Valerie Baker. Now, Valerie Baker happens to not be here today because she's burying her sister-in-law or brother-in-law. So you guys, sister-in-law. So let's pray for them and be considerate of them. But that's the team with kids. Do not complain about the kids' ministry if you don't even plan on being here but once a month anyways. We're just talking. We're just friends. We're like a little family today. I could even sit right here and I could, you know, we're just a family today. Sorry, Joel, I'm taking your little instrument. Don't come and tell me about our kids' ministry when you ain't even coming but twice a month anyways. What we need, you know what we need from you and from people that you invite and bring here in this community? We need you to be committed to what the church is doing to disciple your children. Because we want you to back us up. They're doing sweat and tears, like getting ready. My wife was up late last night getting ready to teach some kids this morning. And so when we don't honor them, they get discouraged and they don't want to do the work. We're just talking about getting Sunday morning right, guys. We can't go off and change the whole town until we just get our own act together. And getting our act together is just like we're gonna kill student kids. We're going to do a great job at that on Sundays. And we need you to be there to back us up, to get behind us, and we need you to be committed. We need you to be committed and get behind us and do that well. So they go to kids. We haven't even talked about, even gotten here into worship yet. You come through these doors, you realize you got an AV booth, you got Matt Joy, Adam Grigsby, Mike Spain, who's got back there with a mask on. Praise God for him. Thank you for coming, Mike. We're so glad you guys are back there. If you're techie and you can run a soundboard, we need you back there. These guys will get tired if they don't have you. So we need you back there. Worship. If you got worship gifts, start telling us, because we don't know if you have worship gifts. Talk to Connor. They worship, they get together and they talk about commitment Saturdays, every Saturday. They're getting ready for Sunday. So these are the teams. And we got security team. We got a little art thing going on, but I'm not going to talk about that right now. But we've got all of these teams and all of these people and all of these leaders, and it's all for the temple experience. It's all for just getting Sunday right. And we've got to get, we can't just do everything. We do first things first, we do that well, and then we move on to second things. And the layer one of church revitalization and church planning is just starting out somewhere. When are we going to meet? What are we going to do? Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to meet on Sundays, and we're going to worship, and we're going to hear the word. We're going to start there. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to do it well. And we're not going to move on to lots of other things until we've done first things first. And the next thing we're going to do is we're going to do life groups. I love the word life group. We've had the word life group around our facility and our church for a long time now. We're going to keep that name. Life group is really great. And we're going to have a church not with life groups. We're going to have a church of life groups. So they're cells of the church that may multiply. They may divide. But they don't just die unless they're unhealthy and you have to kill them. Cancer cells. But cells that are committed to the vision of the rest of the body. Because a cell that's not committed to the rest of the body is a cell that's cancerous. So what we want is healthy life groups committed to the vision and direction of the church that you are known by. We want you to be known. It says in Acts 2, verse 42. If you look in your Bibles, I'll just quote it to you. They devoted themselves to the apostolic teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayers. So our life groups are going to take Acts 2, 42, and they're going to do that. Right? We want to have the similar devotion that the early church had to both the small and the big church. And we've got to have these two layers. This is makes our cake yummy. We got to have a good layer one and a really good layer two. It's like a four-layer cake. If you ever had one of those, they're great. Thank you, Mom. So the life groups are going to be, you're going to be committed to the apostolic teaching. The apostolic teaching is the New Testament. We're going to go through the New Testament to the Old and learn the Bible, so the Word. The Word of God is an essential element of any average life group. And it's just that daily bread. We need you to have a connection to the Word of God in community outside of just Sunday morning. We need you to be known. And that's why it says committed to the fellowship. In Acts 2:42, it says committed to the fellowship. The word fellowship's koinonia, and it has an implication of possessions, that you're actually sharing your possessions with these people. You know them so well. You know them so well that when they haven't been able to pay their car insurance, you actually have that problem and that burden that you're helping them carry too. You're so connected to them that when they don't have a job, you're praying for them to get one. You're so connected to them that you know what they're really looking forward to. It's called being committed to the fellowship. And that's why there was sharing going on, because you don't get to know somebody really closely and them be hurting bad and you not try your best to do something about it. So there's a possessions element that happens in community and in love. And let me tell you, it's not socialism. The difference between socialism and the church is this. Socialism is at the national level and it forces you. The church is at the local level and it releases you. And it says you're free to give. And it says you're free to contribute, you're free to give whatever you want to God. But no one's going to come take it from you. Now, so life groups committed to the fellowship and they're committed to the breaking of bread. That's a prayer element, that's a food element, because who you eat with is who you're intimate with. So the breaking of bread, you know, it's like we kind of have a cheeseburger society where we just kind of go by McDonald's, we get our cheeseburger and go. But in most societies, you actually have to cook your food. And when you cook your food and you sit down and you actually look at each other and you eat, it's like something's going to happen there. You're going to actually get to know the person you're eating with. Who you eat with is who you're intimate with. So having a food element, a word element, a fellowship element, and then having a prayers element. One of the hardest things to do is to pray by yourself. And that's what we tell the church like every Sunday. Read your Bible and pray every day, pray every day, pray every day. And I really want you to do that. I'm not saying that's bad. That's a great thing to do. But first things first, let's just get real. You're not doing it, okay? You're not doing it. And so, hey, this is one of those get real churches where we just kind of tell the truth about ourselves. And so here the truth about ourselves is, you know, we're pretty much not doing it. But let me tell you, the early church do that too, and that's why they did it together. You want to pray? Pray with your wife. You'll start praying, and you'll start making stuff up. And you'll just keep going because you don't want to look dumb like you don't know what to pray. And you'll stay focused. You know how when you pray, you think about everything else in the world and you get lost and you like get bored. But when you got somebody there listening to you, that you start praying like you know what you're doing. And honey, look at me. I can talk to God too. And so praying in community is so much easier than praying alone. Like my wife knows this. It's like, I pray with her because I need to pray with her, not just because I'm supposed to pray with her. I pray more with my wife than I pray by myself. And that's just because that's how she's my help. She's my strength. And so they're devoted to the prayers. And notice in Acts 2:42, it says prayers plural. And what that means, if you're reading between the lines, prayers plural, is that they had prayer hours. They were committed to the prayers, meaning there were prayer hours, meaning the church kept the temple religious program, which was to pray about three times a day. They were morning praying, they were noon praying, and they were night praying. If you pray three times a day with the church, you're talking about Holy Spirit coming, this is going to be fun, this is devotion to something that's going to bring about the presence of the Holy Spirit. Because when you start praying like that, and you start talking to God like that, and you start seeing what God does, things just start to get, there's a momentum just starts to go, and things start to happen in the church. And so they had the commitment to the prayers. And what I'm suggesting is not that we get together and pray three times a day. What I'm suggesting is that we just simply start with first things first. Let's get Sunday morning right. And let's get life groups right. And in the new year, we're going to do membership, like church membership. And we're going to want every member to be connected to a life group leader. Connected to a life group leader. Now, one of the things that we're going to change... one of the things that we're going to change is the email of everybody's prayer requests on one email is really great for a small group and a lot more difficult when you have 200 people you're trying to communicate with. We want to stay connected to each other, but we want to do it through ourselves. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take our life group leaders, and then they're going to take the prayer requests, and they're going to take the pastoring, and they're going to take a lot of the responsibilities of care of the church. So your life group leaders coming up. Alan Whitaker. I'm really, Justin Murray. Holler, Justin Murray, are you in here? He's serving. He's teaching. And he was building a ramp yesterday. You know that? Our church built a ramp yesterday. It was like, great, if you weren't there, you missed out. This big fun. I wasn't there. I was in Alabama. I had a really good excuse. It was far away. But we got Justin Murray. We got Alan Whitaker. We've got Larry Baker. And I'm going to forget some. But kind of like Raleigh's got her own group going. Holler for Raleigh's group. Yeah, Raleigh's got her own group going. And we've asked Andrew Gordon. He's answering me today about whether or not he's going to do it. And so what we want you to do is get up under these leaders and become a part of a community that just doesn't die. Churches usually kill their groups and then re-sign them up for the next year. We're not going to kill our groups. And we're not going to tell our groups, like, here's how often you have to meet and all that. We're going to let groups have some autonomy and some structure to them, and we're going to tell them to meet and to follow Acts 2:42. Okay, so are we having fun?
Yes.
committed to these two things. Can we do that? Devotion. Devotion to the temple and devotion to the table. And devotion precedes the presence. And so if we can get those two things down as a church, we're talking God's going to show up. Look at Acts 2:43. It's this great word. This great word right here. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. It says in Acts 2:42 that they devoted themselves. And then it says in Acts 2:43, and awe came upon every soul. The devotion is connected to the awe. Things are awesome. Root word of awesome is awe. Things are awesome when you have when a church is devoted, when you're devoted. And all I'm saying is you got two things to be devoted to. You want this church to fly? We got two things to do forgive me, the millennials say kill it. We don't mean kill it in a bad way. We mean kill it in a good way. So we're going to kill it. We're going to do a good job of life groups. We're going to do a good job of the Sunday morning thing. And then what's going to happen is awe. It says, and here's what's going to happen. Awe is going to come upon every soul. You guys are going to be coming to me, and you're going to be like, you're not going to believe what happened in my life group. You're going to be coming to me, and you're going to be like, you're not going to believe da-da-da-da-da. Because awe is going to come upon you because you are going to be a devoted person. And you're here today. You're devoted. You're here today. You're devoted. And God's already working in your heart today because of that devotion. But awe is going to come upon the church. And we're going to be able to see the stuff. You ever read the Bible and you're like, whatever happened to the stuff? You know, I want to do the stuff. You know, Jesus talks about how we're supposed to do the works that he did. And it's the least quoted verse in the Bible. And I think as a Christian, I'm like, man, I really wanna see the signs and wonders that God shows people who are devoted. I really wanna be a part of a church where the unexplainable's happening. I really wanna be a part of a church where we teach that God is actually still alive. And he's still breathing, and the Holy Spirit's still moving. So we're talking about a full church, full of the Holy Spirit. I want to see God do things that you cannot explain except by saying only God. And if God's going to do those amazing things, you've got to have a church that's devoted. And the other thing we got to have is a church that's risky. Because if you're going to pray big prayers, you're going to put yourself out there, you're going to hope that God shows up. This is a whole nother question for next week. Are you in the place as a person where God can and will show up and do the unexplainable? Because until you get, like a surfer knows he has to get on the wave before he can actually surf. And if you're not in a place where God has to show up, then you're likely going to see less of the works of the Holy Spirit in your life. So next week, we talked about the full church last week. We talked about being full again of the Holy Spirit this week. And we're going to talk about the full person next week. The person, the individual person who's full. We're talking about corporately how we can be full. Well, next week, we're going to talk about full person. We're talking about Stephen. We're talking about Stephen because this dude, he's not an apostle, so you can't say, well, the apostles, da-da-da-da-da, they're the only ones that can do miracles. No, Stephen's not an apostle. He's just Johnny come lately, and here he is full. He's full of the Holy Spirit. So next week, bring your friend. It's going to be great. We're going to talk about how you can be full and how God can do through you the unexplainable. That is powerful. A church devoted is a church that will fly. Is a church that's full. And we got to keep it simple. And what I'm telling you, this is simple. Temple and table. Can you remember those two words? Temple and table. If you have both of those aspects in your religious life and you're committed to both of those, you are going to grow. And we're going to do everything we can to mobilize you so that you do grow in that way. So temple and table. If we have people committed, like we've gotten, people in the past have been committed to this church. We are just going to see God do amazing things, and it's going to be awesome. It's going to be awesome. I think of Karen Lowe. I think she's back there with the kids right now. She taught me when I was growing up. Now she's doing it second gen. She's on her game. She's doing this the second time or the third time, and she's like really knows what she's doing. I'm like, yes, I want my daughter back there under Karen Lowe. I know her kids. They're still in church today. They know the Bible. That's amazing. She's been committed for years to this church. She's been devoted for years. And you got to decide as a family where you're going to be devoted at so that you can actually have that healthy, full life. I think about Irma Izzard or Karen Close. Think about Karen Close lost her husband. Her son had to move away. And here she is still devoted to the church. And Irma Izzard lost her husband, still devoted to the church. And these people that just give so much, if we can do that with them and join with them, we are going to fly as a church. And you Chamberlains, man, y'all move away and you come back and you've done that three or four times, and that's just awesome. There's just so many committed people, so don't be offended if I haven't mentioned your name. The one thing I want to ask as an application is that you get involved in the temple and the table, but the table element we're not going to do until the new year. We're going to start recruiting, and building these cells, and then we're going to launch them like the first or second week in January. And so you don't have to feel like you're missing out if you haven't gotten a phone call yet. You're probably going to get a phone call from somebody, and you can be thinking about who God's calling you to kind of be under, which one of those life groups would be the place for you. So that's concerning life groups. But as it concerns the temple, which is the Sunday morning gathering, the statistic for people showing up on Sunday morning is 1.9. Church-going Christians go to church 1.9 times a month. That's the statistic now. It's kind of accepted by a lot of people. And how do you go 1.9 times? Well, that means you leave early, I guess. Yeah, that's weird. Anyway, so at best, twice a month. Well, that's just not devotion. I'm sorry. It's just not devotion. You're devoted to other things besides this. And you're going to reap the benefit. You're going to reap what you sow. Devotion. So what I would love to see, this is what the standard I want to hold up for our church. 7 out of 8 Sundays. Can you be at church? If not here, somewhere. Hopefully here, because you need to be at one place to be known. 7 out of 8. Can you come to church 7 out of 8 Sundays? We'll give you one off every 2 months. If you come 8 out of 8, you get extra credit. We're going to do brownie points in 7 out of 8. That's what I want you to consider being committed to. Guys, there's a lot to say. But as usual, this ends with Jesus. So Jesus is filled with the Holy Spirit. And Jesus is devoted. And when you think about the cross, he's got his arms spread wide. What else can a dude do? I mean, he's devoted. He's just got his arms spread wide. He's given. He's like, his hands are open because he's let go of everything. And he's just got like devoted written across his chest, because that guy was super committed and devoted to the church. And he was devoted and he was filled with the Holy Spirit like nobody has ever been filled before. And that's because he had this kind of mentality. He had this kind of mentality, which is like, hey, I'm letting go of everything so I can be committed to the things that matter most. And so Jesus is spread out just like, hey, let me show you the way of being full. Let me show you the way. This is how you do it. He just opens his arms and he shows the world how devoted he is and how devoted you can be. So, church, that's the sermon for today, okay? You glad I'm done? No. Devoted. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you, God. We are so excited to know that it's that simple. Because if it was super complicated, Lord, I just don't know if I could do it. But I think being devoted to the big gathering and being devoted to the small gathering, Lord, is something I can do. And I just want you, Father God, to fill us in our devotion. Because, Lord, the church is reborn and revitalized only when the Holy Spirit shows up. And I want to say the word awe. I want to say the word awesome more here. I want to say the word, oh my word, here. I want to say the word, are you kidding me? Here. Lord, I just want to, Lord, do what only you can do so that only you get the credit. Please, Lord, come. Like we want to be whatever kind of devoted we got to be to see a God like you work in our midst. You turn seas into highways. You turn graves into gardens. This is only what you can do. Do only what you can do at this church, Lord. We just ask that today people would be filled with the Holy Spirit as we gather again in worship and take communion. In Jesus' name I preach, amen.
Take a moment today, tomorrow, the rest of the week, and like Ross said, just be devoted to listening to the Holy Spirit, what he's calling you to do. And I just pray that whether that's here working or even working in the community, that you listen and take that opportunity, because you don't know how it's going to bless somebody else. Have a great rest of your week. Thank y'all.
What?